Welcome to the Town Hall Conversation as part of the Melbourne Conversation Series, Melbourne Global University Educating Our Future, presented by the City of Melbourne in collaboration with the University of Melbourne. I'm Hamish Coates, I'm your moderator, Professor of Higher Education, University of Melbourne. I'd like to start by respectfully acknowledging the custodians of the lands, the traditional owners of the Kulin Nation, and paying my respects to Elders past and present. Thanks so much to this audience for joining us for tonight's event. And in particular, thanks to the City of Melbourne and the University of Melbourne for hosting. This is part of an ongoing series at the University of Melbourne and also at the City of Melbourne, and a true collaboration in terms of moving conversations about tertiary education outside of the traditional campuses in which they've been placed and into the community, in which we need to make particularly sure that people understand the enormous value that tertiary education has to bring. International education alone, so that is education of people who are not Australian citizens, is the largest export in Victoria. 40,000 full-time jobs, or thereabouts, $4 billion to the Victorian economy, and I haven't even started to talk about the research and development contribution, as my colleagues on the panel may well. Of course, Melbourne City, rated by some ratings, the top five city in the world in which to come and study. That's pretty amazing, given how far away we are from many aspects of the world. Cultural corridor, which I enjoyed walking down from the University of Melbourne today. And of course, as I walked here from the University of Melbourne, an enormous cultural diversity, which no doubt we'll hear about from our speakers. Delighted to be joined by the Honourable John Brumby, Professorial at the University of Melbourne and Monash, and of course, former Premier of Victoria, Ms Sally Capp, Victorian Executive Director, Brumby Council of Australia, Wesa Chau, Director of Cultural Intelligence, welcome. Professor Peter Dawkins, Vice-Chancellor and President of Victoria University, Ms Jane Favaloro, Manager of Study Melbourne, and Dr Aung Co-Win, Senior Research Fellow at the University of Melbourne. Hmm. Please welcome our panel. We're going to proceed in alphabetical order, so John, I invite you to give us your thoughts.
I think it was alphabetical order. All right, well, thank you very much, Hamish, and thank you for the opportunity. We've got a lot of speakers, so I'll be very brief, and then we can get into the Q&A or even criticism, and we'll see what comes. But I think when you look at universities, one of the most interesting books that I read in the period I was Treasurer and then Premier was by Richard Florida, and US academic, and Florida's idea was about creativity and creative cities. And his view was the cities that will succeed in the future are those that are most attractive to what he describes as the creative class. So that's people in education, it's people in research, it's people in development, it's people in arts and culture. And I think there's a lot of truth in what Florida writes about. And indeed, my experience in government, all of the investments that we made in education, in research and development, in science and technology, the reality was it attracted some of the best scientists from around the world who wanted to come and to be in Melbourne to be part of that that element of creativity and to enjoy too living in the world's most livable cities. So I think our universities are great centres of creativity. I think they generate job growth, but they attract people from all around the world who want to live in our cities. Hamish mentioned some of the figures about exports. I think education now, our universities, are great drivers of economic growth. Hamish mentioned some export numbers. The figures I've got, in fact, are even bigger than that, that our exports from Victoria, 175,000 full fee-paying overseas students, are worth $5.6 billion. And to put that in perspective, it's considerably larger than the exports which we generated at the heyday of our manufacturing industry. And that's not to diminish the importance of manufacturing, but it's really to highlight just how significant education is now as an economic driver for us. I was at a lunch today with the Australian-Israel Chamber of Commerce, and I was introducing Glyn Davis, the Vice-Chancellor of Melbourne University. You know, if you think of Melbourne University, just up the road, 67,000 students now. 67,000, 8,000 staff, $2 billion in turnover, $1.2 billion each year in research and development. And Melbourne Uni could be even bigger really, except that they've got constraints on the sort of growth that they can achieve. And I'm sure Peter will talk about Victoria University as we go through. Just looking forward, some of the issues that I think about. Can we see more growth in international students? And I think the answer to that is, if we want to, the answer to that is unambiguously yes. You know, in China last year there were 7 million university graduates. By the way, a third of them in science and engineering. But of those 7 million, many will want to go to Melbourne, to Australia, to Victoria, to one of our great universities for a postgraduate or PhD qualification. Australia at the moment, 1% of the world's economy, we get 6% of the world's international students. So we do very well, but my own view is, providing we maintain livability and quality, we can be even stronger in this market. I think a second issue is how we can add further jobs to the economic powerhouses that are universities. And I'm very attracted to the Cambridge model. You know, if you look at the Cambridge hub, developed more than 20 years ago, within 5 kilometres of Cambridge, there was something like 57, 70. Sally's probably got a better idea of this. She spent a few years in London. But it's tens of thousands of jobs generated in small businesses, all of them as a result of the R&D and drive of the universities. I think we can see more in the commercialisation area. Melbourne and Monash University have just got together to create this company called BioCurate. They've put $60 million in. I chair that company. It's designed to get our wonderful research and development through the first, what we call, valley of death, where it's too early for venture capital, no one wants to fund the research to get through that first stage. And that's a great collaboration between the two universities. We rank amongst the best in the world in research, but we're not very good at development. So I think getting together on ventures like that is very much part of the future as well. And the final thing I want to mention, I saw in the audience here Hayden Wright from Australian Education City. This is a proposal which is for the West, for Werribee, again drawing particularly on Chinese and other international investment to create a huge education hub in our western suburbs. And I think the more you look around the world, the more you think about our reputation, the more you look at people's interests in coming here, the more I think there's great potential to grow that as a hub and to build and to lever off further R&D opportunities. So I'll leave it there.
Thanks, John.
Excellent. Well, a great segue for me, John. Thank you. And I've got some notes because I'm so enthusiastic about the topic of education and Melbourne that I could talk all night, but that's not really fair. So I'm going to keep myself to some notes. But just to build on some of the comments that John made, which is really identifying and appreciate some of those direct benefits that the tertiary sector has for our city and our community, is to also have a perspective on what might be some of considered the more indirect benefits. And as John mentioned, I had the opportunity to work as Agent General in London for 3 years, and David Buckingham, who was also an Agent General before me, is here tonight, and John was our boss, so we'll be well behaved. I'm going to tell you all the good things. But what was so interesting about getting that perspective on education in Melbourne and how important it is, for example, that when we were talking to investors, big companies, about coming into Victoria as a market and Australia, of course they were looking at their business cases and trying to understand those commercial imperatives for making that investment. But one of the other very important aspects that they asked about every time was, what was our tertiary education sector like? And of course, the quality that we were able to present for Victoria, and the importance that we place as a community in education was something that was very important and high in their consideration, and very much in favour of Victoria as an investment destination. something I hadn't really appreciated until I was part of that environment. And another big tick in terms of investors looking at us as a market. And of course, when they do come in, not only are they doing it because they know they'll get very talented people that are ripe for the jobs, they also know that they have good sources for continuing education for their teams, whether they're local or people that they've brought into market. And it also was a testament to the sort of community that we are, to value education in that way. So that was absolutely fantastic. Another aspect of that international perspective, and many of you have probably seen examples of this, is that people that have studied here are more likely to come back and work and live and invest here. And so that experience is not just for the time that they're actually in Melbourne studying. It has a longevity to it. And so the quality of that experience that they have both through education and in that sense of place of Melbourne as a community and what we have to offer is absolutely compelling in terms of the decisions that they're making into the future, particularly economic decisions they're making into the future. And then just one more thing on international perspective, and I say this to kids all the time, is that every time you come into contact with an international student, you are setting yourself a network for the future. And those networks run both ways. And I know that we've got others that will talk about this. But it's so exciting for me to see some of those relationships actually flourish into opportunities both in other countries around the world where you are going to visit and work, and also, again, in the longevity of opportunity that happens for everybody here in our community as a result of those relationships. But we have to put the investment into those relationships to make sure they work. And then more recently, working with the Property Council, good to have something that's relevant to my role today, Hamish, thank you, is really that sense of place. Many years ago at the Committee for Melbourne, we set up a couple of schemes, particularly for international students, to help them have a sense of place. And one was a welcome card, we called it, so that they had entree or special experiences offered at our cultural attractions around Melbourne and Victoria. And we also, one of our groups, set up the welcome desk at Melbourne Airport during peak times. Again, so you have that sense of place as soon as you arrive. It's so important in terms of the quality of experience that our international students will have, but also, again, as a reflection of the sort of community that we are and that welcoming sense of place. Just to finish on the last point about developing, there is no doubt that the significance of the international student market is helping us shape our city. The need to respond to the market in terms of accommodation needs for international students has changed the way that we're thinking about accommodation in Melbourne, and in my view, that's for the better, because we need a diversity of accommodation options, and international students have really opened our eyes to different ways of living. And one of the great benefits from that has been increased focus on open spaces. It hasn't just been because of international students, but because in the whole, and having lived in London, I know this as well, we need more open spaces to share because we live in smaller places. That's really driven a lot of that engagement in our community spaces, and I'm so grateful that we've seen the market shifting, and we see that with some of our new suburbs. And just one final point, we've got some great new precincts coming into Melbourne, Fisherman's Bend and Narden Street are great examples. We've had a lot that we've learnt from Docklands. What's the one thing we wish we'd done more of when we started Docklands? Education. And so we're learning from that, and I absolutely believe that higher education, secondary and primary as well, have key roles to play in creating vibrant precincts within our wider Melbourne community. So I'm very excited about that. That was it from me, Hamish.
Thanks, Sally. I'm sorry.
Thank you.
Wesa.
Well, thank you. That actually leads into what I was going to say.
Good, so we planned really this earlier.
Well, first of all, when we talk about international students, we talk a lot about the economic benefits that we get from international students, but what's less discussed is the cultural and the social capital that international students bring. And coming to Melbourne to study, a lot of them bring with them their culture, their passion, and also, you know, the curiosity to learn. And I think by having those people coming over here actually changed the way our universities actually function. And if you have a look at the university classrooms now, it's so incredibly multicultural. And you can almost learn about the world by going into those classrooms and having those conversations with your fellow students. But at the same time, that obviously with universities need to create more spaces where this could happen and facilitate those conversations a bit more and to increase the conversations around multiculturalism and how that actually works. And I was on a fellowship this year to India and Malaysia. And what was really interesting was that when I was talking to some of the researchers over there, to even just the people that we were connecting with, many of them know about Melbourne. And they know about Melbourne because they either studied here themselves or because they have a friend who studied here. And I think, you know, if you have a look at that picture, we know why that international education is so important. Because, you know, people know about this place and this hub, even just through talking to their friends. And international students also, when they go back home, they become ambassadors for Australia and Melbourne as well. And they promote Melbourne as a city. And many of them, if you ask a lot of international students why they picked Melbourne as a place to study, is because of the multiculturalism, but also safety. And this is very important when parents tend to choose the place of destination. That's safety is one of the most important thing, and I think, you know, it's one of those areas that we need to continue to work on to ensure that when students come to Australia, that they're well looked after, but also that their safety is well looked after as well. And also the other thing, like I said, is the multiculturalism that that students really value in Australia, because when they think of Australia, they sometimes don't really see us as a multicultural city, but then when they come here, they realise that they actually have a lot of people that they can really talk to from all different countries, and they really value that. But one of the things that I think we need to really think about for the future is how do we diversify some of the organisations that we have in Australia to make it even more diverse, to on boards, on committees, to make sure that we've got that cultural diversity that understands the world, and how to actually bring some of the international students to Melbourne even more. Because I know that a lot of the Asian countries especially, their universities are also improving. So what happens is a lot of them now go to, say, places like Singapore, to Hong Kong, to Malaysia. Some of the universities are doing really, really well. And so in the future, we'll be competing with those universities. So it's not just Australian universities anymore. It's about diversifying that education and making sure that we know how to capture that market and how to, you know, bring those international students to Melbourne, because it's such a lovely place and a vibrant place as well. Just on a last point about cultural diversity is that, I mean, if you have a look at our former Lord Mayor John So, he was an international student himself. So, so if you think about the benefit that international students bring to Melbourne and bring to Australia, and he did incredibly well for Melbourne, this is the type of thing that we really should be thinking about. How do we actually use some of the capital and the talent that we've got through international education?
Thanks, Hamish. So I'd like to begin by agreeing with everything that the three previous speakers have said. Melbourne is a great city, a great multicultural city, famous for being one of the most livable cities in the world, famous as a great university city alongside cities like Boston and Manchester. And there's no doubt that Melbourne's economic, social and cultural life has the potential to be further enhanced by taking advantage of being a great university city and being a great place for international students. I do, though, want to make my contribution by saying that that there are some risks for the future of Melbourne which we have to guard against. And that is that we may get unbalanced economic and social development. And it's a little bit linked to what John Brumby was saying earlier about we need some development out in Werribee, and he's had some ideas about how we might do that through the Australian Education City. But as we become a bigger and bigger city, what's happening in Melbourne is that more and more of the benefits are occurring in the centre of the city. And the investments in higher education have mostly been in the east of Melbourne, in Melbourne City. And we've got this very rapid population growth in the west of Melbourne, out in Melton and Wyndham, up in the north of Melbourne. And so a big challenge for the city is, how do we spread the benefits of globalisation? How do we spread the benefits of being a great university city across the whole of our city? Because if we're going to be a truly great university city, it is one that uses our universities to achieve a balanced growth and balanced development across the whole of Melbourne. Now, I would say that, wouldn't I? Because I'm the Vice-Chancellor of University in the west of Melbourne, and the only university based in the west of Melbourne. And look, I think the creation of Victoria University was a really good contribution to trying to achieve balanced growth, because John mentioned the numbers for the University of Melbourne. Well, we have 40,000 students, mostly based in the west of Melbourne. We contribute about 4,000 jobs to the region, about $600 million worth of economic activity. But the population growth is enormous in that region. And the employment growth, unfortunately, is not strong enough to soak up that population growth. And so more and more people are having to travel into the city for their jobs. And there are pockets of significant disadvantage and unemployment being created across our region. So somehow we have to keep investing in our university city, in the export of higher education, in the benefits of globalisation, but bring the whole of Melbourne into this great venture. And Victoria University is having a red hot go at trying to do that. We're working with the City of Maribyrnong, for example, to turn Footscray into a university town. And I think that's going very well. That, of course, is in the inner west. That's quite close to the city. Then if you go a bit further out, there's Sunshine in the middle of Brimbank, which is one of those areas of significant disadvantage, and we're building our polytechnic there, which is developing TAFE skills for the region. But we also have to try and help that region avoid significant disadvantage. So one of the examples of what we're doing in Brimbank is we've got this collaboration with the council monitoring the development of disadvantage in early childhood in schools and figuring out what has to be done in order to make Brimbank as well off in terms of economic, educational, health outcomes as the rest of Melbourne. And that requires a lot of research and innovation and preventative health strategy. And so we're using the best minds to try and generate economic and social development in Brimbank, which starts off with investment in early childhood and good schooling and a lot of preventative work around health to counter that disadvantage. And then further out in Werribee, yes, we'd like to see some stimulated economic development out there with that rapid population growth. And one of the opportunities is to work with the Australian Education City. So we're having a red hot go, but I think that that it is also a challenge for government policy, federal and state government policy, to try to stimulate more of that globalised economic development in regions such as Brimbank, in regions such as Werribee, or else this unbalanced economic development is going to be a threat to globalisation, a threat to multiculturalism. We've seen, you know, what's happened with Brexit. We've seen what's happened with Trump, and then you'll get opposition to the very sorts of things that create opportunity for people if we manage it well. So things like innovation clusters, things like those precincts that you've both been talking about, we've got to make sure we get them spread in different parts of the of Melbourne. Victoria University is trying hard to do that, but I think it needs some government intervention and some government support to make sure that we spread this exciting development across the whole of Melbourne. Mm. Thanks.
Thank you.
Well, thank you, everybody. It's an absolute privilege to be in the company of this particular panel. And I'm delighted tonight just to share with you a little bit about the Study Melbourne story and what our focus has been. So, in fact, Study Melbourne as a brand for Victoria was born in 2006. And at the time, it had very much a destination attraction policy that looked at obviously going into eight different markets and pulling all activity, mainly at the higher education sector, into Melbourne and Victoria. I've had the privilege of bobbing in and out of international education and tourism for probably the last decade, doing a bit of work in food and fibre as well. And what I noticed when I stepped back into Study Melbourne about 2 years ago was that, in fact, the marketing effort of place and institution and the way that they play together had actually changed. The institutions were still doing the destination attraction, and we were noticing that consumers were making choices even as young, and the latest research shows that Chinese students as young as 11 are deciding what they want to be when they grow up, and they're very, very focused about it. And what we've been able to do at Study Melbourne is actually to shift some of our focus. Where can we add best value? Where can we collaborate with public and private sector coming together? And the area that we've landed on is around student experience. So in the time in being back, and in fact earlier this year in March, we launched the International Education Sector Strategy. It's got a $32 million funding with it over the next 4 years. But it's not just about international education. It's actually a sector-wide approach which the Andrews government is very committed to, about actually leveraging other sectors. So where we've had certain sector activity drop off, and certainly it has hit some of the regional towns, we've been able to actually align investment and the visitor economy, some of the fintech work and international education. And in many other sectors, education sits at the very heart, and it is the lever, whether you're talking about domestic opportunities or you're talking about international ones, that will probably for Victoria have, and for Australia and many other of our competitive cities around the world, it is the biggest lever in which we can truly compete but also make a real difference. So Study Melbourne actually oscillates around the student life cycle, and Sally brought up the wonderful example of the student welcome desk, which I had the also an opportunity of getting some early insight. And we collaborate with that project in particular, which has now got a permanent hub at the International Arrivals Hall, and does actually lever with Visit Victoria there as well. But it does provide a dedicated service when students are actually hopping off those planes. They all get goodie bags, and that is a public-private deal where, in fact, you know, there's other ancillary providers coming to that. In terms of, as though we're coming around from destination attraction around the life cycle, what we do for students to actually really embrace them and put them at the heart of everything that we do, a lot of the work comes out of the Study Melbourne Student Centre. So that I'm privileged to be working with five full-time social workers. We've got a 24/7 support line, and we provide free information and support for all international students. Those also obviously right across the state. Institutions love it because they can send students there for a range of different things, positive, negative, sometimes obviously where you can get, you know, highly vulnerable communities as well. It provides, from an incident management perspective at a policy level, an opportunity for us to do a whole lot of social listening. We can understand then what are the issues that are facing students today, cost of living, accommodation pressures, maybe perhaps changing their courses. And what we also do in that space is obviously in the digital site. So we've developed over the last 2 years the largest online international student community in Australia, where we've got over 500,000 active users, both as prospective students, but also as an onshore engagement opportunity. And then coming back to where we play with the sectors, I wanted to make Melbourne and Victoria amazing on the world stage. We wanted to actually amplify what we were doing. But we knew that one institution brand was only as good as its competitor. One city working on its own only had that much budget. If in fact we collaborate, we can actually build these experiences. And probably the one that we're the most proud of, which has just become a finalist in the Australian Multicultural Marketing Awards next week, is a collaboration that we did with the Virgin Australia Fashion Festival. Six institutions came together, from hair and beauty to fashion, created a Four Seasons in One Night campaign that was showcased as part of a cultural extension. It was education and tourism playing right on the world stage. We had ABC International come, we had student bloggers, we had other journos from around the world push that content. And from Study Melbourne's marketing budget, it was a tiny amount, but such value and such enduring value. So we're looking at how can we actually, you know, we don't have a Sydney Reef and Rock. And coming from an international tourism background, and I used to work in London for Tourism Australia, I knew that we could hang those icons off place and identity. We don't have, you know, obviously a Tower Bridge or a Buckingham Palace. However, we have amazing institutional brands. We actually have an ability to collaborate and probably on the world stage. And in fact, I've just had the privilege of coming back and presenting Melbourne as a city in focus in Berlin to over 2,500 people because we are the second best student city in the world. The way that we have done that is through collaboration. We're a small place. We can punch above our weight if we actually work together. And I think probably the last point that I just wanted to leave with everybody is that as a mum of two girls who are young, they're in primary school age, we are dealing with an audience that are job creators, not takers. So how do you develop resilient people that can be mobilised around the world, whether they're in their classrooms now or they're actually travelling to other places? Mm-hmm. And I think the other piece that we can't forget is that we do have 2.4 million active alumni around the world. How can we harness that activity and drive further economic and social benefit for Victoria in the longer term?
So thank you so much for the excellent contribution and the comments about the future of the education. So given that I'm a last speaker, many of the points has been picked up and discussed, as I really like expected. So anyway, so it's a great honor for me to be involved in this particular panel. But before I discuss the future of the education in Melbourne, so I want to tell you like very brief background of mine, like very brief myself, because that will like lead to my perspective. So I'm from Myanmar, so it's a like developing country, which is also known as Burma, where Aung San Suu Kyi lives. Anyway, so I came here in 2008 to do a master's degree in the University of Melbourne. So I did a master's degree and finished in 2009. At that time, I'm the only one Burmese student at the Melbourne University, to be honest. So it's like one of the like the most difficult times in my life, like especially in the 2008 to come over here, but it is a major decision for me. So what happened is like, but after the 2009, I got a job here, and then like I worked for 1 year here, and then I did my PhD and finished in 2013. But for this PhD, I was very lucky because I got a very good supervisor and the support from the University of Melbourne. And for that, I won a lot of the awards, including the like Premier's Award for the Health and Medical Research and Chancellor's Awards and everything. Yeah. So I got a, like I can establish the academic career in Melbourne because of the so many resources, especially in the biomedical research. So what I would like to mention here is, Melbourne is like is a very good place for the education. We all know that. Everyone already reads light about that. But to parallel with the other education city like Boston and Cambridge and Manchester, I think we need to a bit more work on the research area, not only on the education aspect. Mm-hmm. Because like research and development area, Melbourne is very good, especially for the biomedical research. I know that because especially in the pathway light precinct. So pathway precinct is the one of the best biomedical research area in the world. But I'm not sure about the other principles like IT and business. Do we have enough light precinct like for that research and development area? So I think we need to work a bit more on the research area. This is what I would like to raise. And the other one is to attract the researcher, we need to give more scholarships and the like, and also the training opportunity as well. So example, the postdoctoral fellowship and so on. To compare with the local opportunities, like for the international students, it's quite like very few like for the international students. So we need to develop more on the like the opportunities for the international student, especially in the research area. Not only for the multicultural exchange, because we need to exchange their ideas and talent and intelligence. This is one thing we need to work on. And the other one, like in terms of education, like Sally and like we already mentioned about that one, the two main things of the Melbourne education is the safety and the multiculturalism. So whenever like when I like was invited by Hamish, I was thinking, what's a good thing about Melbourne? One is the safety and the other one is the multiculturalism. But the on the other side, Melbourne, like we still need a bit more the accommodation and the like student campus life. So as an international student, if I want to get a like world brand named, where should we go? So for example, myself, I would think about that I would go to Australia or US or the UK. But given saying that, the tuition fees of these top universities are very similar. Well, one was Australian dollar was very high. The Australian, like for example, Melbourne University tuition fee is the one of the like most expensive one in the world, more than Harvard and Cambridge University, like several years back. So why do we need to pay this tuition fee? It's a major investment for students as well as the family life. So to get a like the world brand degree plus what else? So we need to like think about more. And also I think we need to we need to deliver the student's life, especially for the campus life. And the other one is the transportation. The transportation becoming better in Melbourne, especially in this year, but I think maybe more like opportunity or better transportation or maybe some in like discount for the students or whatever. I think we need to give more attractive like discussion, I think. Yeah. So thank you.
Excellent.
Thanks, Aung, Sally, Peter, Wesa, Sally and John. Imagine I'm down there in Antarctica in a tent and I have a three-year-old. How on earth would I decide that investing in their education across their lifetime is better to send them to Melbourne as opposed to many other cities around the world? Everyone.
Anyone
well,
jumping in?
Anyone.
I think you've got the answers off the panel tonight, but just the notes. Melbourne's diversity, cultural diversity, Melbourne's safety, the multiculturalism we've heard about, the quality of the education, the quality of the lifestyle here, all of those things would mount an extraordinarily powerful case to say that Melbourne is the place to be and the place to go, notwithstanding all the other very valuable suggestions, which we'll get to in other questions and comments about some of the risks going forward and the things that we need to address. But I think as we stand, all of those issues and the fact that if you invest in education, all of the evidence still says that if you've got a university degree, you will have a better prospect of earning a higher income through your life than someone who doesn't.
We started the University City Index many years ago with RMIT when I was at Committee for Melbourne, and we decided we really wanted to understand where Melbourne ranked as a university city. And what were the criteria that were going to go into those rankings as we looked across the world? We started with the Economist's Livability Index, because within that you have issues like safety and transport and accommodation and culture and all of the things that go into making a city livable. So we thought that was a great start. Then we also included a view on the variety of education possible in cities. So not that there was one core institution, but only that, but that actually there was a breadth, and then add to that also the quality of that breadth. Because then we knew that when people were coming to study here, or the people already here, in terms of their options, that actually were broad, because that also meant that there was a breadth of opportunity. So we included that. And then we also included access to jobs. Because, and we're seeing it now in the way that universities are ranked, more and more the employability aspect of ranking and rating is becoming weighted more highly, because we have education, as John just said, to create opportunities. If the opportunities aren't there, it sort of seems like a bit of a waste. And from Melbourne's perspective, when we were looking at it, we were very interested in, are we actually creating the environment in which people can apply the talents and their education into our economy and community? So we get the prosperity and we get the stronger community. So we combined all of those things into the index. And when we did that, and obviously still I haven't looked at it recently, but I think Hamish, you mentioned number five. I think we were three in the first year that we did it. And we actually rechecked it and we sent it to the economists so that an independent organisation was checking it across all of the criteria and the ratings to say that we came in at number three. And I think as an independent verification of those aspects that are important to us as a city, where you're 3 year old living in a tent. Hope you've got a few books down there, Hamish, just to start the education. There's lots in the environment, but I think they've really set us up well as a destination for education. I know there are ways we can always improve, and that's a good thing, because we don't want to be complacent either.
Yeah, so I think there's a whole lot of really great stuff that we have in Melbourne. But also one of the things that I remember talking to a friend who studied in Melbourne and then did another course in another country. And one of the things that she said was that in Melbourne, she didn't realise, but having been to another country, that the support services that we've got in Melbourne is very, very good. Whilst there are certain things that we can improve on, obviously, but then the opportunities and also the support services that we have at universities and also through the Victorian government has also been very, very good. And I still remember the time when John was still Premier and working on issues around international students, and setting up the international student care service at that time was incredible. And now obviously it's now been rebranded to Study Melbourne. But those are the support that you need as international students, and to be able to create a society that that is safe for international students, and so that you've got a place where you can go to when you are in crisis. And I think that's one of the things that is very important for any students who are studying overseas.
So it's clearly important if you're in a tent in the Antarctic that you have a copy of the world's university rankings. Hopefully you do. And so the rankings of university cities put us up there. And in the recent Times Higher Education rankings, six of Victoria's universities were in the top 400 in the world, including Victoria University, I'm pleased to say. And that puts us in the top 2% of universities in the world. So, and it does turn out that those rankings are very important for international students. So if you're in that tent in Antarctica, that's probably what you need. But if you're anywhere else in the world, you need that, but then you need to have contact with students who've been there, and they need to be telling you that this is a really good experience. Mm-hmm. And, that's what determines flows of students. It's reputation, but then it's this word of mouth. And that's why the quality of the student experience is so important as an investment for us in the long term, rather than seeing it purely as a cash cow export industry. And I think there is a lot of attention going into that, but we need to put more.
So probably to convert this particular segment of the audience, I would turn to many of our talented students, not just international ones, but use, I think, probably the talent that sits within Victoria, which is in the gamification space. So how can we use peer-to-peer? Not B2C, not B2B, but actually peer-to-peer to convert interest and get them to create a game that's entertaining, that's full of infographics, that sells all of the rankings and the content, but actually gets collaboration going in a live setting that would be appetising and appealing to various levels of the community. And I think, you know, doing things like that, that's a little bit perhaps left of centre, but at the very heart of what our curriculum design looks like now, from primary school age right through, could be something that we could certainly work on.
So I'd like to add one thing into the discussion. In addition to the employability, I think we need more like opportunities for the graduates. So including the job opportunities as well as the internship opportunities. Because when I discussed with the several of my like our friends and the colleagues before this talk, what is the like major need for the after the graduation is jobs. So many of my friends are now jobless. It's quite a shame, even though they are graduated from the like Victorian universities. So I don't know. It's a like very difficult issue. Like not only in the Victoria and then across Australia, I would say that like the job opportunities we really need. Some of the students, they don't need a job. They need the training. So I don't need many, but I want to learn what you are doing. So all of the volunteership or the internship opportunities, but especially in our area, the opportunities for the internship is very rare. So that's the one thing I do add.
So, I mean, clearly the seeds to what we have today were laid 20 years ago, and I wonder what the community and higher education need to do together to set up the next 20 years. And there's been some suggestions today. I could talk about tertiary education forever, given my passion, but there are many people here. So why don't we take an initial round of questions or contributions from the audience?
Hello, my name's Meryl Darlitz. Isn't it easy to be self-adulatory? Mm-hmm. Melbourne is a fantastic place, but I put it to you that we're not really so interested in multiculturalism as all that. Outside of the education sphere, we're not really welcoming refugees in this country, and our antipathy towards people coming in from outside is just beneath the surface. I think that what's going on is that we are unashamedly using students from international countries to get economic benefits for this country. We're lucky, we've got a fantastic city here, and we've got a fantastic academic background in the universities. But maybe we need to go deeper, and I think that Aung Kerwin is absolutely on point here. Because we need to ask ourselves, why are we putting students through this? Are we just trying to get money from their families? At the end of this, will there be jobs, not just for them, international students, but also for our own children? The world has changed, and the prospects for people who have got university degrees is most definitely better, as John Brumby's pointed out, but maybe that is because their families had the wherewithal to put them through tertiary education. They have connections and they can find jobs amongst their friends and relatives for their children. The university education of itself may not be particularly worthwhile. I think we need to ask ourselves just exactly why we're doing this.
Good evening, Stephen Nagel's my name, from Holmes Institute. I have a question regarding online content of higher education. The national code prescribes at the moment that international students can do 25% of their course online, and there's been quite a push from the universities to increase that, to increase it to 35% or 40%. And the biggest group of people who opposed that were the International Students Association, who said, well, they hadn't come to Australia to go online. And I wonder what Peter thinks, what you think, Hamish, that universities are going more and more and more online, And is that a threat to the student experience?
Mm-hmm. Thank you. My name's Anthony Ciminello from Bridge World International, property consultants. I'm just looking at the two words, educating and future, and the two words that I think we hear the most in industries today is disruption and innovation. And I just wanted to know what the universities are doing about investing in the curriculums of the future. Because I don't know what the statistics are, 40% of our jobs today are going to be obsolete in 10 years' time or something like that. So that's my question is, what about the jobs of the future? What are we doing about those sort of curriculums and developing those?
Mm-hmm. Thank you. A question about deep cultural interconnectedness, maybe beyond the commercial facets of provision of education services to foreign citizens and online education, and I guess university curricula of the future. Over to the panel for any reactions.
So I think there were some important connections between those questions about, you know, what are we trying to do at universities? Are there really going to be jobs there? And that's linked to this issue about disruptive innovation. And so it is true that that a tertiary education is becoming almost essential for people to have success in the labour market. But having said that, the labour market is becoming an increasingly challenging place even for university graduates. And the traditional view of universities where you learnt certain skills and then you went out and practiced them in a way that, for example, trained to be an accountant, trained to be a lawyer, and then you go and get those skills to be employed. The world is changing towards one in which what employers are increasingly looking for is students with initiative, students with entrepreneurial skills, students with problem-solving skills, who are going to go and help them solve their problems rather than just do sort of mechanical tasks that they've learned about at university. So that's the world we're moving into. And so that is a big challenge to the pedagogy of universities. And I don't know whether we've responded rapidly enough to it. So one of the things that I'm doing at Victoria University is making entrepreneurship a high-profile concept. And I've employed a number of entrepreneurs in residence and asked them to come and disrupt the university and to help students learn about how to do things out there in the real world in a way that's going to make a difference, which conventional curriculum probably will increasingly be challenged about. So, and I think that there's a link between that also and multiculturalism, because in my view, cultural diversity and the cultural competency is one of those competencies that's going to be very important for the future. And so that's where learning from international students, learning from our own culturally diverse student community, and that's another advantage of the West of Melbourne, where we have a huge cultural diversity, and the international students, in the sense of cultural diversity, kind of blend in, and that has to be turned into an asset. So we have to think much more deeply, I think, about what we're trying to do, and also, you know, measure how successful we are in really creating capabilities in our students.
Yeah, so I might just add to that. In terms of cultural diversity, it's definitely an area that I think we can do a lot more of. Because if you have a look at all the universities and even support staff for international students, many of them are not very diverse. And you would think that former international students would become support staff in the future, but that's not the case. So I think, you know, even within universities, we can really think about cultural diversity and how do we actually making sure that the workforce is diverse in itself. And just linking into innovation as well, I do a lot of work in the cultural diversity space. And I know that a lot of the people of cultural diverse backgrounds, they get to a certain point in their career and then move out to start their own business because they can't get through that ceiling. So many of the people who try very, very hard can't get through to senior management, and so they leave. So I would invite any one of you who might be in a position to really look at that, critically examine your human resource strategy to see whether or not there are more pathways for people of different cultural backgrounds to to actually move up into senior roles. And many of those, and the reason why we need them is because they do think differently. They contribute different areas that we might not think about. And I think, you know, that's one of the things that we really, really need to think about. And if we have a lot more of people of different cultural backgrounds starting their own business, you can see that, you know, you can already see a future where there's a lot of disruption because the traditional organisations don't support that. That's why they have to start something else in the something else themselves. And in terms of online learning, it's an interesting one because I actually did a course that's online and I really didn't like it because you don't really have an opportunity to talk to other people, even though you've got structures in place where you discuss. But as you know, text is not the same as getting to know the person, and sometimes the tone in which you say certain things can be very different from what you write. And I think whilst you can create online courses, it needs to be interlinked with some sort of an overall student experience strategy where you do bring people together and integrate the whole system. And without that, I think on itself, there's no reason why people need to do a university course, and then you can do some free ones from Stanford University and, you know, some, you know, really big brands where you can do online courses for free. So I think our universities really need to think about this and making sure that the international student experience is a crucial part of what universities are offering.
We do have in Victoria a very innovative university actually started here called Doucere, and that started on the basis of everything's online. So they've got undergrad and they really kicked off with their MBA. And it's an amazing platform that brings business leaders and their learnings into a curriculum that's supported by the University of Canberra, but it's all delivered online. What they realised very quickly was that they needed to find ways in which students could engage. So they changed their model somewhat. The majority of it is still online, which is terrific innovation, and they bring leaders from all around the world to deliver lectures, and that's a differentiator. But they have also introduced lectures that people can attend together, discussion groups that they have. Some of those are also using internet. They listen in and engage with lecturers from Harvard. They might be doing that online, but they've also got the opportunity to do some physical engagement as well in the different major cities around Australia. And so I think that's been a really interesting experiment of online needing to also be supported by that collaboration and that sharing and that engagement. So they started all the way from the other end and they ended up introducing some of that engagement. Just on the curriculum of the future, this is so interesting for any of us that have children, particularly because we are concerned about it. And to pick up on a point that was made earlier, I got to listen to Muhammad Yusin, who's the grandfather of microfinance, a Bangladeshi gentleman that started with $42 and loaned it to 27 people, and he's now built the fastest growing bank in the world called Grameen Bank, which is another word for village. And he comes out here regularly. They've just set up a branch and they do microfinance, economic development and build community and community strength and prosperity. And I asked him, what are the projects in Australia? And he said, oh, we don't have any projects in Australia. We do have an entity here, but we fund projects in other developing nations in the region. And I said, well, surely there are areas of need in Australia where we can combine talents and use microfinance. And he said, my greatest worry for countries like Australia is that you have incredibly high levels of education, which developing nations aspire towards, but you've created generations of job seekers. Yes. And where you're at in your economic development, you actually need more job creators. Mm-hmm. And so what are the skills you're giving your kids to help them be job creators? Mm-hmm. And I went straight home and started talking to my boys about exactly that. And it's not easy. And I really acknowledge the universities and the efforts they're all putting into this sense of entrepreneurship. But there are all sorts of life skills that come into that as well. And other skills, when I say life skills, I mean communication as well. Essential skills to be able to actually create something out of nothing, and with that something actually start employing other people, and then we'll start to see some of those opportunities. So if we're starting to shift our focus towards that, then I think that's an absolutely essential thing.
John? Yeah, I was just going to add to that, and I think there are some different but related themes, as Peter said, in the questions. And you know, to go to the first one on the growth of higher education and overseas students. I mean, this is, you know, call it an industry if you wish, but it's only 25 years ago you couldn't take a student from overseas who'd pay a fee. So I guess we weren't trying to be self-adulatory. We were just saying that really it's quite a remarkable story in 25 years, and that's not to say that it's perfect or that it can't be challenged, or as we've heard today, there's lots of things we need to do for making sure we've got a better geographic mix, Peter, to go to your point, and Wes's point about more cultural diversity, more cultural opportunity, because Wes is dead right, you know, despite the number of students that we come through and the diversity we've got in Australia, that's not fully reflected in our senior management positions or on the boards of companies that run Australia. So I think we've got further to go. But I just want to back Sally's point here about the changing nature of the universities and what students, and the changing nature of our economy too. You know, when I was at uni, it doesn't seem like that long ago, but I know it was a long, long time ago. You know, there were very clear career paths. There were very large established industries, particularly in the manufacturing sector. And, you know, you had a pretty clear view of that's where you could go. But if you think about our economies today, there aren't big, lumpy employers. You know, you can't find a new Toyota or a Ford or one of them and just find 5,000 jobs that go with it. And it's interesting hearing Peter talk about entrepreneurship at VU. At Melbourne Uni, they've got the Melbourne Accelerator program there, which is really about turning ideas into good businesses. Mm-hmm. And it's just a runaway success. You know, it's only been going 2 years. The dinner we had just a few months ago, all of these students have created new businesses. They're already generating jobs. Glyn Davis is fond of talking about the surveys of the students about what they want to do in the future. And a high proportion of students from across the universities, they don't want to work for someone in the future, they want to create their own business. So I think this whole thing about creativity, about generating jobs, about starting your own business, about entrepreneurship, we haven't been very good at that in Australia. That's just, you know, it hasn't been in our culture, really. We've been job seekers, as Sally said before. So I think this is a big cultural challenge, Onko, and it goes to some of the things you mentioned before. So if you're an overseas student, you know, and you're paying a lot of money to come to study here in Melbourne, part of that experience that you want in a university, it won't just be the academic drill, it'll be thinking more broadly, life experiences, but also how to create your own business, perhaps an export business, you know, and so I think this is a big cultural challenge for our universities.
Alison Gutierrez from CGU University. I am a former international student myself. I used to be an agent, and now I am part of the university. And I have really passion about promoting Melbourne as a destination to study. I really believe we have to offer a good quality of life for our students, a lot of potential for them to develop and grow professionally. But I believe that is something that we have a lack there, and is about a myth that I have when I arrive. I have a myth that Australia was full of Australians. I didn't have any experience, or I didn't meet any Australian people until I did 2 years when I was studying here. And it was, I tried harder, to be honest, to meet people. I went to every single festival in Fair Square, I went to every single meeting, conversation, even if I didn't understand a lot of English, but I was trying to integrate with the Australian society, but it's a challenge there. How to build a bridge between communities and international students, because we have a lot of activities for international students with international students, which is great. But how it is translated to societies and how we can integrate the communities, the Australian communities, to collaborate with the international students, and how we can integrate that new ideas and full of passion and love. And how I believe that sometimes nobody hears what we need to say when we want to express, and we would like to contribute, even if it's for free, even if it's working really hard. But I believe it is a bridge to cross, and I believe universities have a crucial role there. So I just would like to know your opinion about that. Thank you.
I'm Claire Glacombe from Bastion Reputation Management. Mine's not related to international students at all. There was a piece today by the University of Canberra doing a piece with preschool students around STEM education at that level, and I'm curious about what lessons are being learnt from primary and secondary school levels of education, because there's been a lot of talk about jobs of the future, but learners of the future will be completely different again, and their experience of technology will be different. So just around comments on curriculum and designing spaces and technology for learners of the future.
Thank you. And I just, the gentleman with the beard and this lady here.
Thanks very much. My name is David Buckingham. Firstly, I'd just like to flag that the International Education Marketing Program started in 1986, and I know that because I started it. Mm-hmm. The second thing that I'd like to point out is that my previous role for 6 years was as in charge of the international recruitment of overseas students to Monash University, and there were several issues that were intensely debated within Monash at the time. The first was this question of multiculturalism. What was the experience of the international student? And the point that has just been made by the lady up the back came through quite strongly, that survey work and other ways of testing student sentiment were that the students were spending a lot of time with themselves, not with Australians, and that the multicultural experience was in fact lacking. We actually had a situation where one of the postgraduate programs at Monash University, 95% of the enrolled students were Chinese, and they course could have been taught in Mandarin, and it would have in fact seen almost all students fully understanding what was taking place. But these are just points of detail. The question I've got is really addressed to both Peter and to John around the Australian Education City initiative at Werribee. Where is that at, and what degree of support is there for that as a means of providing both for some of the alternative approaches that are being canvassed here tonight and being canvassed more generally? And what is the scope for extending into the western suburbs the experience? A lot of people are saying that vocational education is going through a crisis. That's detracting from the attraction of this market, and that it makes it more difficult to get initiatives like this one off the ground unless it's very carefully thought through as to exactly what the offering is and whether there is support for that offering.
Thank you. Kerry Bennett from Graduate House at the University of Melbourne. My question relates to the redundancy of universities, many of which in Melbourne and across Victoria are offering exactly the same course. And I'm wondering, in the future, should we be looking at a bit of co-opetition? We're cooperating, we're allowing both our domestic and international students to pick and choose and move, and therefore distribute the equity of this billion-dollar industry from university to university.
I think so. I think, and again, some commonality, building a bridge across cultures. If we had 250,000 people from outside of Melbourne suddenly coming to live here, would we do it again the same way? I believe that is roughly the figure of international students living in the city of Melbourne. And not least, if we think forward 10 years, we immediately need to start talking with people in early childhood, let alone senior secondary school. Those decisions and life thoughts are made early. And how do we best create the architecture or infrastructure of the future to do that? And not least, is the sector, in as much as our 40 universities, which are all doing comprehensive research work, the best way of seeing forward that future? Colleagues?
I'd like to add one thing, like before we move to another topic about the future education of Melbourne. So in the Mardi Gras lesson, we discuss a lot, but one point what I want to mention is after the graduation, most of the international students also like tend to live in, like after they get in residency and whatever, like as Sally said, I'm one of them as well. So I'm a migrant now. So what happened is, for these migrants, like personally, what I do is I'm from Myanmar, so Myanmar is like one of the least developed countries in the world. So what I'm trying to help is my home country. I'm connecting with the Adam Medical University and hospital in Myanmar, and then I'm trying to build the, I'm trying to help the like the capacity in the medical research area in Myanmar, which is like that they don't have. So what I'm saying is I'm not like selling my profile. What I'm saying is all the international students are the same. Not only myself, I ask my friends in the United States or the other countries as well, the same thing. And also like several of my friends from the international like background as well, like Sri Lanka and Thailand and like India and several other like students like who are former students here. And they are now migrants and they are living here. And what they are doing is they are trying to help their home country by bringing the like capacities and all the aids they can like bring from Melbourne and Victoria to back home country. So what I would like to say is not only benefit during the student life, after the student life as well. So they can bring all the capacity here, at least not, may not be many, but at least some like capability and ability, and then bring it back to the home country. This is very good thing what I see is because it's the like interchanging between the different countries, it will benefit like for Melbourne as well as the Australia in the longer term, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, just in relation to the question about you know bringing international students and other people of different cultural or local Australians together. One of the challenges is a lot of, like the lady who talked previously, that a lot of programs are either one or the other. It's never really together. And the challenge is really, if you do have a program, how do you actually attract local people as well as international students? And often the marketing strategy actually need to be different because they're actually looking for very different things. So for an international student, they really want to engage with local people, and many of them really want that opportunity, but they don't know how to. But on the other hand, for local people, you really have to give them a reason for them to get involved. And I think there's a lot of people with the goodwill, but then at the same time, because they're running their lives, they're busy doing their own thing, they're not actually looking to find international students to you know take on or you know trying to welcome them. And so I think that there needs to be a lot more work in looking at how do we actually bring together all the people who actually do want to engage but not necessarily looking at the time. And if you actually ask them, many of them would probably say, yeah, you know, definitely, I welcome them to a Christmas lunch or, you know, Easter dinner. So there's a lot of opportunities there that we're not really trying to bring together. And I think universities can do a lot more to assist that. And previously, I've actually ran a program that tries to bring international students into organizations to volunteer. And programs like that is really, really good because then not only international students get an experience in, you know, in work, but also at the same time, organizations also get an opportunity to get to know international students. But there's a lot of work that goes around that and there's not enough support in that you know, the support that goes around it, because people assume, oh yeah, well, you're looking for volunteers and therefore everything is free, but that's actually not the case. You need to organise it, you need to talk to, you know, various providers, and creating that opportunity will assist international students after they graduate to actually find a job, because that's one of the problems for international students, is not being able to find a job after they graduate. But if you have an opportunity to volunteer and intern, then it's much, much easier. And also, another point that I just want to raise is I was running a project called Tech Fugees through Univer-City earlier this year, and the number of people who were actually involved in that, and some of them were actually international students who were really interested to, and former international students, who were really interested to support refugees. And so we got together, it's called a hackathon, where you bring together a whole lot of people and they come up with ideas on a new business where you can support refugees. So I think there's a lot more opportunities where we can bring together international students and local students, but also to solve an issue. So, you know, through that experience, through and Univer-City is an organisation I started, to create more of these opportunities for both people who are looking to solve social issues, but also to actually create business as well.
Yeah, I just wanted to comment quickly on Claire's question about STEM. And so it's different to sort of all of the others, but this is a big challenge for Australia, I think, as the audience knows, you know, a huge challenge for Australia. And it's got sort of two elements. The first part is what's happening in schools and then what's happening in the universities. It was really interesting. I had, there was a visit recently from the chief scientist from Israel out here, and I had dinner with him and we were talking about these issues. But it's interesting to look at what Israel's done, because they're doing pretty well in tackling this problem. And one of the things they've done is a bit of, in a sense, it's a bit of rebranding, if I can put it simply. So they have courses in cybersecurity. So they run them at university, but they've pushed that down into years 11 and 12. And you might say, gee, you know, why do kids at school want to learn about cybersecurity? But cybersecurity is really math. You know, it's algorithms, it's probability theory, it's big data. And so they've pushed this down, and everybody wants to learn about cybersecurity, but it's really maths by another name. In the school system also, we've got some examples here in Victoria of space science centres that we funded. One of them's out at Strathmore Secondary. Why did we do that? Because boys in particular love learning about space. And what is and so they're doing this in Israel as well. What is space science? Space science is really physics by another name. And then the other one, of course, you know, for anyone who's had kids and brought them up, a lot of kids, junior, secondary, primary school, they get obsessed with dinosaurs, right? They love dinosaurs and things like that. Well, dinosaurs is really biology. So they've pushed these subjects down, some of them, and they've had a lot more interest just with... So slight changes to curriculum, but really same old stuff, but a different brand. So we've got to be doing a lot more of that, I think, in Australia. I think the second issue, just very quickly, and I don't pretend to have an answer on this, but you know, you can study, you can do an arts degree, and you'll have 12 hours maximum face to face, probably less with a bit of online. If you want to do biomed or be a lab researcher, with all of the face-to-face, you can't get out of it for under 30 hours a week. I know this because one of my daughters did this at Melbourne Uni. And for a lot of young people now, there's, you know, a lot of competition with their time. And I think this is an issue. You know, if you do many other degrees, then you've got sort of 12 hours a week. If you do anything in the science and biomed area, you can be up to 30, 32 hours a week. And can eat into the time that you want for a part-time job or whatever. I don't pretend to have an answer on that. I just say that it is an issue. I know I hear that from students. But the bottom line is we've got a big, big, big challenge with STEM in Australia. And we can encourage, you know, more of our own students in schools to study it. Alternatively, we can draw on more international students. And then, of course, we need to find the pathway to ensure that they've got job opportunities in the future. Mm.
I just wanted to add to that on this pedagogy issue. A couple of months ago, we launched at the Q campus the Centre for Learning and Innovation. Now, that was a five-year project. It is five levels high. And at the very top of it, it has the United Nations room, which I have the privilege of attending board meetings at, but it's got all of the flags of the world. Now, one of the things that we've been doing on the pedagogy side is obviously looking at the way learners learn. Now, yes, this centre is for Year 7 to Year 12, but I was involved in a workshop last week with an amazing group called the Education Changemakers. I'd recommend that you all Google them after this. But basically looking at STEM, but obviously in the more recent terminology as well, and in fact Melbourne's just been named as a recipient of the Global Science Network, and I was in London a couple of weeks ago having a look at their King's College precinct. Melbourne has it. It's coming in collaboration with Melbourne University to the old Women's Hospital in Carlton. But basically that's also bringing in the STEAM element, so the performing arts. And coming back to children at the age of, you know, kindergarten, 3, 4, maybe even, and my pet desire is really to kind of bring it down into the childcare centres, where you've got young learners as young as 6 months to kind of 6 years in childcare, and their rapid rate of growth, as well as obviously the hours in which they may be in these centres. How can our students, whether they're international or whether they're domestic kids, they're students, they're global kids, actually contribute to the learning environment of some of these younger kids? That will actually start, I think, to change the very value and story of education globally. It's not an international story and a domestic story. It's students learning together and sharing their knowledge. And I think that's where, you know, we're probably silly to think that, you know, classrooms these days, whether you're in a university context, whether you're learning online, it's a triangulated model, or you're in a classroom, should be the closed door with the teacher at the front. It's about that collaboration, and it's about being involved and problem solving and having skills in resilience that will actually build these kids and their, obviously, capacity. And the final one is, which is another newer acronym, is ESTEAM. So actually bringing the entrepreneurial part, which we're starting to see, you know, obviously really come through with many kids in schools, but also obviously in the university sector as well. And if you could actually add in the entrepreneurial and the performing arts for the release and some positive psych, I think we'd have some pretty amazing Victorians.
Thanks, Jane. We've got 5 minutes, so I'm going to take the moderator's privilege of asking the panellists to each make a closing remark. Clearly, we can only open the bracket of the conversation here on such an enormous topic. What is the one single thing that we could do better in Melbourne to make sure that for the next 20 years we are a global university?
Yep, I'll start. John. It's a better link between research and development. So, you know, in Australia, but particularly in Melbourne, we rank amongst the very best in the world in terms of the research we do. If you look at biomedical research, you put Melbourne and Monash universities together, top five in the world, like as good as the best in Boston or London or New York, wherever it is. But when you look at how we translate that into commercial opportunities, in the OECD, out of 33 countries, we rank 33rd. You know, we're terrible at translating it. So you think of that great brain power that we've got in our universities, you know, right across all of our university sector. And as you heard from Peter before, so many of them rank in the top 400 in the world. But what we're not good at doing is levering the commercial opportunities that come from that. And part of that's finance, part of that's policy, part of that's entrepreneurship, part of it's failure in industry itself in Australia. But I think this is the big thing. And if we do that, it'll also create the job opportunities that have been brought up by members of the panel tonight. And David Buckingham, to your question before, you asked about Australian Education City out in the West. I think they're preferred tenderer, but one of the things that they're trying to do in that project is a much closer link between education, research and commercialisation to provide that throughput, if you like, and creating the shared value that we all want to see from that investment in education.
Thanks, Sally.
It's a really tough question to finish on, Hamish. Thank you. If I was going to say one thing, I think that we really need to look at our education system in leaps and bounds instead of what I feel is incremental improvement. And a lot of what we do is consider where we are now and how can we improve. And I think that a lot of this conversation today has been about where will we be in decades' time, and let's move back from that to see if we can take all of these issues and actually push them on at an accelerated rate than that which we're moving at today. If we are truly in the world of change and disruption and something we should all feel comfortable with as a foundation, then we do need to look forward more than we are. And I think if we do, then we'll get a blending of what do we need to make a strong economy in Australia that will bring in the mix of skills and cultures and thinking. What are the things that we need to create strong communities in Australia? And again, bring in all of the various elements for that. And then, as I said, work back quickly to see how we can accelerate our way towards that together with a combination of these things. There are so many great things going on, but often in isolation or without that accelerated mode forward. So it'd be terrific if we can do more joining up on that and some forward thinking.
Thanks, Sally.
And just adding on Sally's point is really, for me, it's about how do we actually create that culturally diverse workforce. Like I mentioned earlier, we have people of culturally diverse background who are working, but then at the same time, they're not in senior management, they're not in our boards. And even at universities, we don't see a lot of diversity. And making sure that we actually bring those people together and actually use those talents that we actually have in Australia. And I mean, one of the stories I share is sometimes when even organisations who are wanting to expand overseas, they might have an advisory group of people of that particular country or people who understand that country, but then the decisions are usually made already by the board. And if you're not at the decision-making table, then you can't really have that voice to say, well, maybe actually that option is not a very good one, and therefore you have a look at other options as well. So making sure that diversity is there is very important at the very beginning.
So I'd emphasise, I think, the word collaboration. And John Brumby's talked about industry-university collaboration to promote R&D and innovation, and that's one very important aspect of collaboration. I think another important aspect is collaboration across the education sector. So we need early childhood schools, TAFE and higher education to be collaborating in ways that cause cross-fertilisation with this kind of the student at the centre. It's all about bringing all the resources to bear to promote the development of our students when it comes to the education side. So just an example of that, in Footscray we're developing this thing called the Footscray Learning Precinct, which is a lifelong learning collaboration across the whole sector. And that, and schools and early childhood and university and TAFE in turn have to do the collaboration with industry to make sure that it's not a closed world of education. And then to link it with what I said at the beginning, we need to foster those collaboration, those clusters and those networks in a way that spreads the benefit across Melbourne and doesn't cause it to be too concentrated and promote a divided society.
So I'm going to perhaps just touch on the reverse. I know we've talked a lot about onshore activity, but one of the most I think valuable exercises that I had last year was actually off the back of some of the work that was done in 2005, 6 and 7, which was actually around and beyond, which was around drought-proofing our state. So the North-South pipeline went in, the desal plant. Many Victorians locally said, why are we doing this? And I'm sure, John, you know, you obviously at the time copped a bit of heat on it. What we've actually been able to realise is that the topography and geography of Victoria is actually quite similar to many other developing countries around the world. And so last year, the Minister of International Education took a delegation of 29 senior officials into Latin America, four parts of Latin America. Now, yes, obviously, we now welcome many students from all over Latin America, whether they're here for short-term programs or obviously longer-term. It's an amazingly diverse population, obviously, in LATAM, very, very big place. And everybody is obviously quite different, and they, you know, their skill set and their needs are quite different. And certainly Victoria, from an education perspective, can service those things. But the bit that I liked particularly about this was that we were able to realise our intellectual property and then actually license it to a country that actually values it, whether it's from the private sector or the public sector to the educational institutions, and how then we can actually package that up on a Victoria kind of brand platform to sell that goodwill into something that is obviously of an inherent need to every human on the planet, which is water. And that's certainly now starting to trickle back from not only an economic perspective, but also from a long-term relationship perspective into Latin America, but also other parts of the world, and Myanmar being the other one.
Thank you.
So one thing I'd like to add to all this discussion is about the alumni network. So we discuss a lot of the diversity, multiculturalism, and the collaborations, but the university, we are, as a university, we are not very good at the moment about the alumni network. So we do need to care after the graduation how we keep all these connections and the diversity like between the alumni, not only for the international students, between the domestic students as well. So especially in the higher education sector, like especially in the master's degrees and beyond, the students are very diverse, not only in the multicultural lesson, but also the work experience, education experience, talent, and everything. So we need to exchange a lot of these ideas and talents and diversity skills. But as the like after the graduation, like they develop more and more and more. But as the like the graduates from the like all the university from Victoria, and then how should we exchange all these ideas and keep network within the alumni? We are not very good at the moment. We need to work more than currently. Yep. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. And my view is we need more of these conversations, and so let this be the start. And thank you to everyone who's made this evening possible, the people, but also, of course, the institutions, the University of Melbourne, the City of Melbourne. Thank you to you for joining us, and, of course, thank you to the panel.